Axl Rose is one of the most unpredictable rock stars of all time, famous for hits like Paradise City.
I'm going home.
A juvenile delinquent from rural Indiana, as lead singer of Guns N' Roses, he became an iconic rock god, selling over 100 million records. But with success came self-destruction.
Take that. Going to be on an hour and a half late. We're risking a riot and it's $10,000. Let's go.
He blew up his own group. He blew up his marriage. Axl lit the firework, held it in his hand, and allowed it to explode in his face.
Hell hath no fury like a mad Axl Rose.
There's something very dark and dangerous and uncontrollable about this guy.
The damage to Axl started when he was a child.
And he goes, I'm gonna out my dad.
He beat Axl on a regular basis.
Axl starts to unearth very disturbing memories.
Told by those who knew him best.
We had some of the greatest times and some of the toughest times. We got robbed one night.
A lot of me says I didn't want to do this interview, but I wanted to talk about, you know, real and not any bullshit. He's a completely misunderstood human being.
I actually loved Axl a lot.
This is the story of one of the greatest frontmen in music history, Axl Rose. January 1st, 2001, the House of Blues, Las Vegas. At 38 years of age, Axl Rose is about to make his first public appearance as part of Guns N' Roses in 7 years. But Axl is now the only remaining original member of the band.
It was the first time that Axl had been out with his band, the new band with no Slash, no Duff. It's his first time he's performed in years.
He's performing tracks from a long-awaited new album, Chinese Democracy, that he's been working on for 7 years and still hasn't finished.
The New York Times reported it as the most expensive record ever recorded. One of the reasons it took so long for Axl to complete, he was on his own.
You know where you are!
And on stage, the show lacks the energy of Axl's past performances.
He's devoid of his old anger and ferocious performing style. This is a stripped back Axl.
Even his performance of Welcome to the Jungle didn't impress the critics.
It's a tricky time for him. By this point, American promoters don't think they can sell enough tickets to put the band in arenas.
And there's only one person to blame.
He has this sort of tick inside him that he wants to destroy everything and completely wreck everyone's lives, and then at the last second, by the hair of his chinny chin chin, pull it back together. And I've seen him do that repeatedly.
Only this time, he seems unable to pull it back together.
For him, you know, imagine the humiliation of not being able to sell out a House of Blues with his, you know, new version of Guns N' Roses.
So why did a man who had achieved such extraordinary success managed to sabotage everything he'd created and end up so isolated and alone? The roots of Axl's notoriously unpredictable life lie in his complex upbringing in this single-story house in the suburbs of Lafayette, Indiana. Monica Gregory spent her teenage years with Axl.
We had some of the best times ever. He lived in Lafayette with his parents. You don't make it big here. It's just a hometown. It's a hometown town.
William Bruce Rose Jr., the boy who would become Axl Rose, was born February 6th, 1962. His mother Sharon was a 16-year-old high school student, and his father William was known as a local troublemaker. But when Axl was just 2 years old, his father disappeared. Not long after, Sharon married local minister Stephen Bailey, and her young son became known as William, or Bill Bailey.
Just sit.
Stephen Bailey comes into the picture. He's a Pentecostal minister. He's extremely strict, hated them listening to the radio. All kinds of rock music were the devil's work, would make them read the Bible. Axl told me about sneaking off to, you know, local drugstores just to listen to the radio because they'd be playing it behind the counter.
Axl's little half-brother, Stuart, was Sharon and Stephen's son together. But Axl and his younger sister, Amy, also believed that Stephen was their biological father. It was a difficult relationship from the start.
I met his parents several times. His mom, Sharon, was a lovely lady. And Steve, his stepdad, was pretty tough. My house, my rules, that's how it's going to be.
Axel's stepfather wasn't just strict, he was violent.
And this results in Axl and his siblings having this quite terrifying childhood. If a lady came on TV in a bikini, Axl might get a smack round the head.
He beat Axl on a regular basis. He would beat on Stuart, Axl's brother. He would do things, treat Amy, the sister, poorly.
I mean, this is pretty oppressive, brutal, vicious upbringing we're talking about here, and ultimately very damaging.
Axel's talked about stuffing his emotion and not having any control. Children tend to stuff rage and really have no idea how to deal with the anger that begins to build up every time inside them. And the natural consequence is, as an adult, you want a lot of control.
Despite being beaten by Stephen, Axl never really felt he could rely on his mother for support.
Actually, it was something he was still very upset about and still talking about years later, the fact that his mother never defended him against all this brutality from his stepfather.
He absolutely felt betrayed by his mother. In fact, he talked about the fact that the only time she came in to comfort him was well after his dad had punished him.
Even sleep didn't provide relief.
Axl would have nightmares. He used to share a bunk with his half-brother, Stuart. The nightmares bothered him so much, he actually rolled out of bed, landed on the ground. His teeth went through his lip. I mean, this boy was terrorized at every turn as he was growing up.
The trauma that Axl was experiencing started to manifest itself in his childhood playtime.
Axl himself becomes very destructive, very angry. At one time, he was building model aeroplanes, and then he deliberately smashed them up. It seemed that everything to him only really gained meaning after he destroyed it.
When a child has to stuff all of their emotion, and they can't feel anger, they can't feel sadness, they tend to self-sabotage. For Axl, he self-sabotaged a lot of things in his childhood, but it was his way of dealing with the anger that was inside.
In junior high, he was quiet and fairly shy. He knew he was different. He knew he had something to do. You know what I mean?
In this clip, Axl spoke about his quiet side.
I was very shy and introverted. People didn't see that side necessarily, but that's what's there, and it's still there.
But Axl found solace in music, particularly during his regular visits to church.
Axel's earliest musical experiences involved playing piano in the church, singing along. And he sang with Amy and Stuart, his stepbrother and sister. They sang in church. They were the Bailey Trio.
Axl revealed his memories of that time.
We had the Bailey Trio. I was like the bass then. I was like, one more time, Jesus, lift my head as a bird. And it was so much fun. It was really weird to think about that.
Aware of her son's love of music, in a rare gesture of support, Axl's mother sneaks him a small radio, which he listens to under the bed covers at night.
That was probably one of the only times Sharon defied Stephen and helped Axl out. He did have this tiny outlet with music, and that was when he first discovered Queen, Led Zeppelin, Elton John.
Elton John remained a huge inspiration throughout Axl's life. But his first step on the road to stardom happened at Geffen High School when Axl was 13 years old.
Axl's kind of big break, if you like, comes when he becomes a singer in a school band, in a group led by his friend Jeff Isabel, otherwise known as Izzy Stradlin. Izzy told me the first time he ever heard of Axl was in the school, suddenly heard a big ruckus, big drama going on, books being thrown around, and next thing this kid just running down the corridor being chased by teachers.
Izzy was looking for a lead singer for his band.
He thought, well, that guy's a lunatic. He'd be perfect as a singer. Axl walked out of the first rehearsal. Something triggered him, threw down the mic, stormed off, and then was back the next day. Same thing, I'm never coming back, back the next day. It really was, you know, the pattern that he would then repeat pretty much for the next 20 years.
But school wasn't the only place where Axl was struggling to fit in. At home, relations with his parents were going from bad to worse. Then, Axl made a discovery that would change his life forever.
His mother, Sharon, had always led him to believe that Stephen Bailey was his biological father. But when Axel's 17, he's rooting around in a drawer at home. He pulls out some insurance documents, and there he discovers that, in fact, his biological father was someone called William Rose.
Mom? He found out that Steve wasn't his real dad around the age of 17. Oh, it broke his heart because he didn't know. Nobody had told him. You think that you know where your life has come from, and you've put up with a lot of hard times, and then you find out that, wait, something is completely different than I thought that my life was.
What the hell? This is the trigger for a huge family meltdown.
Come on, man.
But I think the sense of betrayal, because he felt his mother was covering up for his evil stepfather, it all added to his sense of alienation and the fact that he was very much on his own. He also decides that he's not going to be Bill Bailey anymore.
Axl changed his name to Rose, which would have been his birth name, in direct defiance of his stepfather. And I'm sure what he felt was absolute disgust that he had been lied to.
And then Axl, that was the name of the first band. It was just cool. How cool is the name Axl Rose?
Here, he reveals the reason he became Axl.
Axl eventually became me out of Izzy's suggestion. He goes, look, you live, breathe, sleep, walk, talk. Axl, won't you just be Axl? And I'm like, okay, I'm Axl. So then we called the band Rose. So I still got to have the band named after me, you know, so that was cool.
He would later legally become W. Axl Rose. The initials W.A.R., War, would appear to sum up everything Axl became.
Thanks to the lame-ass security, I'm going home. We're out of here.
Axl Rose is one of the greatest rock stars of all time. Yet, he continually destroyed everything that made him happy or successful.
Axl Rose was the definitive self-destructive frontman.
It was a pattern that started when he was a teenager. Having discovered his father was actually his stepfather, Bill Bailey later changed his name to W. Axl Rose. Having been in constant conflict with his stepfather, a Pentecostal minister,
There were endless arguments with his stepfather. You know, Axl could do no right.
Or what?
Tensions were at the breaking point.
His father said his hair was too long. He needed to get it cut.
Don't touch my hair.
And like so many teenage boys, you know, that's the deal breaker. I'm not getting my hair cut.
Axl decided to move in with his maternal grandmother. It's a time that Monica Gregory, one of Axel's teenage friends, remembers well.
So this is Grandma Ann's house. This was like the funnest place ever. There was a lot of Axel's developmental music here. He would sit and play the piano after she got it for him. She accepted him on his own terms. He loved his grandma, and she was one of his best friends.
But having left home, Axl started to drift.
Axl was a proper juvenile delinquent. He was arrested many times by the police on various misdemeanors. He had the typical mugshot taken.
Teenage years are all about rebellion. And in an abusive home, a repressive home, Axl felt the need to rebel. He did it for his safety. He did it for his expression. He wasn't allowed any of those things at home. And he began to protect himself. He went from being shy and in control to wild and out of control. And that was a very big shift.
The motivation to get out of town quick was due to the fact that the police had made it known to him that as far as they were concerned, he was a big, big local troublemaker, and they had their eyes on him.
Axl escaped Lafayette for the bright lights of LA. Monica went with him.
And we got on a plane and went to LA. He knew that he wanted to be a musician, but this is still a little early on in the process, kind of checking it out.
For two kids from Indiana, LA is a whole new world.
I mean, you get an echo of it in the beginning of the Welcome to the Jungle video, where you see this guy getting off a bus and he's actually literally got a piece of straw in his mouth. That was Axl.
You know, we were just exploring Hollywood, exploring the scene. I mean, we did spend a few nights out on, you know, in alleys and stuff. I remember one night we were walking down Hollywood Boulevard. We found a pizza place that had a piano, and we'd go in there and he'd play the piano and they'd give us a piece of pizza every now and then.
Eventually, Axl gets a job at Tower Video on Sunset Boulevard in Hollywood. In 2018, he spoke to Jimmy Kimmel about the experience.
What did you do at Tower Video?
I became a manager for a very short amount of time.
Wow. So would you discipline employees?
I let everybody have beers after work.
You know, it's funny because I think every video store employee thinks they're going to be a rock star one day. You're the only one that actually did.
After a few months, Axl and Monica reunite with school friend Izzy Stradlin, who has also moved to LA from Indiana. It's not long before they form another band named Hollywood Rose.
I was a booking agent at a place called Silver Lining Entertainment, and Axl called me on the phone and said, "Can we bring you a demo?" A couple hours later, he and Izzy showed up with the ghetto blaster in hand, and I was like blown away. I booked them sight unseen. We bonded because we're both from Indiana, so that's kind of where our conversation started. He was very charming and sweet and very likable.
Hollywood Rose eventually fuses with another band named LA Guns to form Guns N' Roses. This is when the classic lineup emerges.
You have Axl, Slash, Izzy, Duff, and Steven Adler. The drummer.
It was the band that was going to make him a megastar. It's like it was magic. The first time I saw them live was like heaven on earth for me. I was so proud. I was like bubbling out of my seat. I was so excited.
The most critical relationship for Axl is the one with Slash.
Slash and Axl were the yin and the yang of the band. Them together was what created the magic. They were the center point, the light, and everything else kind of flowed together as a team.
In 1985, most of the members of Guns N' Roses start living in what is essentially their rehearsal room, a tiny studio apartment off Sunset Boulevard in Hollywood.
And that becomes known as the Hell House, because it literally was a hell house. It was just a shelter, basically. No toilet, no electricity to begin with, certainly no kitchen or any facilities.
I went to visit them one time, and you know, the band lived in an absolute squalor, dust and dirt piled up everywhere.
I mean, Izzy was dealing heroin at this point. Long before they became famous, they were all out of their brains on anything that came along. Axl actually built himself a kind of annex and fashioned a door which he could lock. But the rest of the group were out of control. So Axl has always needed that little bubble of his own, away from everybody, really, that he can feel safe inside.
Despite living in squalor, the band write and rehearse as much as they can. It was Vicki Hamilton's job to try and give them some professional discipline.
I was kind of a combination big sister, mom, manager. I did it all.
So when the band gets into some trouble with the police, it's Vicki who helps them out.
I got into some trouble, and the police were looking for him at the rehearsal hall, and Slash called me and said, "Can Axl sleep on your couch?" But then the police kept circling the rehearsal hall, so Slash and Izzy moved in.
This was the apartment that Guns N' Roses lived in with Vicki before they were famous.
Axl always used to sleep on this couch. That was like his bed. The others like slept in sleeping bags on the floor. Very rock and roll. Well, there were a lot of pizza boxes here and usually no papers. So they would write on whatever they could find, you know. And the TV was up against this wall. This is where Axl like watched Faces of Death and Sex Pistol videos and things. This is the bathroom that he sang Acapella in the shower. It has really good acoustics in here, so it's a singer's dream, pretty much. I think that is the actual tub. This is the one and only bedroom in this apartment, and I had a bed against this wall. We used to like barricade the door so no one could get in here at night.
But the tiny living quarters put the band's relationship under strain as Axl became increasingly difficult.
Axl's personality, it was sort of a two-parter. Like, there's a very sweet little boy personality that emerges a lot of the time. And then when he's on edge, there's like sort of the demon dog from hell personality. Axl's eyes change colors even when he goes into that mode. So it's like you knew if his eyes were lighter that it was time to move along, so.
Hell hath no fury like a mad Axl Rose. When he goes into that mode, I mean, red mist, red aura, whatever you want to call it.
One day Steven was helping me like clean up the apartment because there were beer bottles and Jack Daniels and cigarette butts everywhere. And Axl's like, "Stop it." And then he got up and like threw the heavy coffee table at Steven. And there was like a bra here in the living room floor. And I was like screaming my head off going, you know, "Are you gonna kill your drummer?"
Axl's erratic behavior may have been difficult to live with, but combined with the volatile nature of the rest of the band, musically, Guns N' Roses was exactly what L.A. was looking for.
At that time and point in Hollywood, all the bands had gotten really girly. Like, every record company had two or three sort of glam rock bands. So when Guns N' Roses hit Hollywood, it had a dangerous feel about it.
February 28th, 1986. The Troubadour, West Hollywood. Guns N' Roses takes the stage for an industry showcase. The representative for Geffen Records is Tom Zutaut.
Wow. You know, nothing has changed. The stage looks as dirty as it did 35, 40 years ago. That night, I had to crawl through a lot of people to get there, but I went backstage, and Axl introduced me to everybody. I said, come to my office tomorrow whenever you wake up, right? I'll give you a record deal. And they were like, but you haven't even seen us play. I said, I saw your singer on a stage, so I know pretty much what I need to know. They hit the stage, and it was literally the loudest guitar riff I'd ever heard. It was amazing, because I watched the crowd, and people were like taking tissues out of their pockets and stuffing it in their ears. And
it was a wall of sound. There was no singer like him on the scene at that point in time. He was brilliant. It just felt different, you know, dangerous.
I saw this other A&R person take two cigarettes out of her cigarette pack and stuff them in her ears. They had the crowd from the first chorus of the first song. It was just so magnetic and powerful. And then Wednesday, they showed up at my office, and you know, basically the band said, give us $75,000 by Friday and we have a deal.
But even at this early point in their career, when the band is about to change their lives forever, Axl puts it in jeopardy.
The band signed with me that Friday night at about 11 p.m. when Axl finally showed up for a 5 p.m. meeting.
It's a pattern he would repeat for much of his career.
But the next day they went down to the bank and took all his money in cash. And I found the cash underneath the couch. Yeah, $75,000, which got spent on mostly tattoos and clothes.
The band may be on its way to stardom, but in Axl Rose, it has the equivalent of a bomb on board.
There was an intensity to Axl on everything. He was an intense human being.
His behavior threatens to destroy everything before they've even started. August 1986, Los Angeles. Having signed to one of the biggest record labels in the world, Geffen, Guns N' Roses is recording their first album, Appetite for Destruction.
It's really hard to capture lightning in a bottle. It seems like it would be so easy, but it's actually really difficult.
Slash was already a heroin addict. Izzy was a heroin addict. Producer Mike Clink, one of his first jobs was to say to them, go away and get clean. You know, they haven't released any records. They have no money. It always teetered on the edge of disaster.
But Axl Rose is determined that this will be one of the greatest records ever made.
I've never seen anyone who was so obsessed with every single emotion of every word being 100% accurate to what he was trying to deliver.
Axl has always been a perfectionist. He always knew that he knew how to do it right, and he wanted it done perfectly, if possible.
During the making of Rocket Queen, this drive for perfection leads Axl to make a decision that could rip the band apart, even if it is in the name of music.
We were in New York mixing. Axl felt like something was missing from the song. And then Steven Adler's girlfriend, Adriana, at the time was in the studio, but Steven hadn't made it there yet.
Years later, Adriana spoke about the extraordinary events that followed.
He was like, Adriana, you know, in his Axl voice, you know, there's something I'd like you to do. It's very serious. He wanted to have live sex sounds on a song he was mixing. We were young and wild and free, and there was the notion that it was for an artistic purpose. Of course I would do that.
You know, we mic'd the two of them up, and they went at it, and we recorded it.
I had no idea that it was gonna be rock and roll history, that it was gonna be a legendary act.
I didn't realize that she was a serious girlfriend of Steven's. So, I mean, only dawned on me later, you know, oh, that wasn't good. And it might be part of the reason that Steven and Axl are still somewhat estranged.
As the months of recording go on, Axel's behavior grows even more extreme. And he starts to become physically destructive.
He smashed up dressing rooms. He was always bleeding and hurting his toes by kicking through walls and so on. To destroy things had become part of his raison d'etre.
It's no coincidence that that first album was called Appetite for Destruction. Welcome to the jungle. Anything goes. You're crazy.
Even Axl is aware that his volatile personality could jeopardize the future of the band.
I'm psychotic, and that's a real problem to try to, like, you know, it's like I have to, like, balance out, you know, when can I destroy everything around me to when I have to be nice to everybody.
It was very clear to me that there was something going on.
Axl's turbulent mind is threatening to destroy not just the band, but also himself. At the age of around 24, Axl OD'd on pills. He revealed this dark moment to Kurt Loder.
The reason I OD'd was because of stress. I couldn't take it.
Yeah.
And I just grabbed this bottle of pills in an argument and just gulped them down. No. And I ended up in the hospital.
Eventually, Axl agrees to see a psychiatrist to try and get a diagnosis for his mood swings. Disorder, now known as bipolar disorder.
Bipolar is a very debilitating condition with extreme highs and extreme lows that are very difficult for the person who is experiencing the symptoms. His mood swings, his appetite for destruction, all make sense to a bipolar diagnosis. It also makes sense to his pain, his desire for control, when things, even in his own mind, seem out of control.
He took lithium for a while, which was a common, you know, medication for manic depressives. I think he tried it for a while. I think that at a certain point he thought it made him too flat, and so he stopped taking it. If you flatten him out with lithium or some other, you know, antidepressant, you know, you don't have this. Genius insanity, you know, it was that ride, I think, that made a lot of his creative output brilliant. There was just a raw expression of energy in a primal way.
But not long before Guns N' Roses' debut album is released, Axl meets a woman who will change his life. Erin Everly, the 19-year-old daughter of Everly Brothers legend, Don Everly.
Erin was probably one of the most beautiful women I'd ever seen in my life. She was hot as hell. And they had an insane love affair.
She was a doll. She loved him dearly. They were very happy together at the time that I met Erin. Axel's got a definite romantic side that I've seen with the girls that he was dating. He's got a heart of gold in there.
And in Axel's case, you've got to remember, although he's now a big rock star, he's still that boy from Lafayette that ran away from home. She's the daughter of Don Everly. She's Hollywood royalty. Everybody was so impressed with Axl, still are. Not Erin. And it's one of the reasons he fell in love with her.
It's Axl's love for Erin that inspires one of Guns N' Roses' greatest hits.
Sweet Child of Mine, I mean, is completely, you know, written about her. It was sort of like the purity of pure love.
Slash, on the other hand, hates it.
Slash is just playing around, and he comes up with do 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 do, you know, and Axl goes, man, what's that? And Slash is like, nothing. It's just, I'm just exercising my fingers. No, man, that's great. Axl turned it into a masterpiece. And Slash, for years afterwards, said to me, I hate that tune. It's so dumb.
Although Axl and Slash didn't always agree, Their chemistry had now become the driving force behind the creativity of the band.
Slash did the day-to-day business. And if there were major things, we'd run them by Axl. And Axl was the visionary. They had the perfect partnership. All the greatest bands of all time, it's a lead singer and a lead guitarist that come together and create this magic.
Musical differences aside, after 7 months in the studio, Guns N' Roses finally released their first album, Appetite for Destruction.
Appetite for Destruction was released with a big thud, like nothing happened.
It limply debuts on the Billboard 200 at number 182. With sales of the record struggling, the band needs a break. February 2nd, 1988, MTV special, The Ritz, New York City. This is their first live performance on American television. It has the potential to make or break them, and it almost doesn't happen.
The 1988 MTV special was, in my humble opinion, biggest, by far, the biggest, biggest, biggest break that we had gotten. I get this request, Axl wants to see me, and I come into the dressing room, so what's going on? He said, I don't know where my bandana is. Okay, so I'll go find you one. I brought one back, it wasn't what he wanted. So now I have to find one that actually is what he wants.
I can't go on. I don't have a bandana. What do you mean you can't? You know, this goes on for 20 minutes. Eventually, his manager gets his tour manager to run out into the crowd, try and find a kid with a bandana, say, can Axl have your bandana?
I absolutely thought, if I don't find Axl Rose's bandana, this huge moment in the band's life, he may just not decide not to go on.
Runs back, Axl, I've got a bandana. I don't like it. It's not the right bandana. You were due on stage 30 minutes ago. I'm not going on.
Nothing can happen without the bandana. So it all depends on me. I call the shots. Nobody moves unless I say we can. That is a huge thing to realize. It's all about power.
Back in the crowd, looking for the right bandana, find a kid, runs back. Yeah, that's good.
The band come out and play It's So Easy, and the performance is a huge success.
And that's the bandana you see him wearing at the show. Great show. Rest of the band, particularly Slash and Izzy, so pissed off with Axl. They won't even make eye contact with him on the stage.
Nearly a year after its release, Appetite for Destruction reaches number one on the Billboard 200 chart. It remains the biggest-selling debut album of all time, and it threw Axl Rose into the mainstream. Axl's destructive behavior will shake the band to its very core.
Shuddering at the memory of it. He's going to kill every MF in the room, okay?
But this is just the start of things to come.